The 2008 crash was so severe that it's still considered the greatest financial crisis. In recent history, the United States lost $2 trillion worth of value and 8.7 million jobs disappeared in a glimpse of an eye. That meant that millions of people couldn't feed their families, especially those who live paycheck to paycheck. No one really knew what to do in that case, even the Fed. People lost faith in the banks because they had misused their power and destroyed the economy. As a result of that, banks were the major reason behind the 2008 crash. While this might sound like an exaggeration, it wasn't for many who struggled to put food on the table, but that's not what made people hate Wall Street. Even though they were mostly responsible for the crisis by giving high ratings to junk loans or bad loans. In simple terms, take AIG for example, one of the biggest financial institutions in the US, or to be more precise, one of the biggest until 2008. It purposely gave AAA ratings to loans that they knew were junk loans and their borrowers will default. Why did they do that? You may ask. Just to make money out of thin air. Hello viewers. Steven here, and I welcome you to this channel where we talk about investing, business and finance. In today's video, we will be talking about the truths about money that banks don't want you to know. But before we begin, be sure you have subscribed to this channel and smash that like button on this video to support the channel. Thanks for doing that, now let's begin. AIG made dozens if not hundreds of billions of dollars, but was one of the main drivers of the crisis. Let rally in case AIG did not give fake ratings, the 2008 crash wouldn't be that bad or wouldn't happen in the first place. Although the government didn't bail it out, it is CEO back then Joseph Casano who was given the nickname "The Men Who Crashed the World." Earned an estimated $34 million in bonuses in 2008. Think about it. You literally destroyed a company that existed for almost 100 years. You sent the greatest economy in the world to a recession and left millions of people jobless. Not just in the US but all across the globe, because the US economy is connected deeply with the rest of the world. Especially Europe, countries like Greece haven't fully recovered yet from the crisis that happened over a decade ago, and when you get fired you get a $34 million bonus. How is that supposed to make sense? Why on earth do such selfish people get in such positions in the first place? Unfortunately, that is not the question of this video, but it illustrates to us how greedy these people have become. That's why so many people came to hate Wall Street or the banks in general. However, that is still the tip of the iceberg. There are still far more facts that ordinary people don't know about the banks. How do they cheat people? How do they cheat the government? Or how rich people use banks to make billions of dollars out of thin air and avoid taxes? We'll answer all of these questions and many more, so give this video a thumbs up and let's dive in. Number 1. Fake accounts. Since Wells Fargo wasn't deeply involved in the 2008 crash like AIG or Lehman Brothers, it created a reputation of a stable bank. But that didn't last long. At first glance, it seemed like Wall Street learned its lesson and would no longer get involved in anything fraudulent that will hurt average people again, but nothing has changed since then. In 2016, news broke out that Wells Fargo created millions of fraudulent savings and checking accounts on behalf of its clients without their consent. Wells Fargo clients began to notice the fraud after being charged unanticipated fees and receiving unexpected credit or debit cards or lines of credit. Initial reports blame individual Wells Fargo branch workers and managers for the problem, as well as sales incentives. But the blame was later shifted to top-down pressure from higher-level management to up in as many accounts as possible. Just imagine the bank or the place to whom you have trusted your money is purposefully creating a fake account using your name and your personal information to make money. That is not just afraid but disgraceful. It is normal to sell different financial products to your customers, but in this case supervisors pressured their employees to open as many as 1.5 million checking and saving accounts and more than half a million credit cards without customers' authorization. Employees were encouraged to order credit cards for pre-approved customers without their consent and to use their own contact information when filing out requests to prevent customers from discovering the float. Employees also created fraudulent checking and saving accounts. a process that sometimes involves the movement of money out of legitimate accounts. The creation of these additional products was made possible in part through a process known as pinning by setting the client's PIN to 4 zeros. Bunkers were able to control clients' accounts and were able to enroll them in programs such as online banking. How it is supposed to trust banks after that? That's why people are turning to crypto. Wells Fargo was first fined $100 million in September 2016. $6.1 million in customer refunds due to inappropriate fees and charges, almost $500,000 settlement for a shareholder class action lawsuit. By December 2018, Wells Fargo had already paid $2.3 billion in settlements and constant orders, but no one went to jail. In fact, top executives still managed to earn their bonuses that were worth millions of dollars. Number 2. Borrowing money during high inflation. The system is designed in such a way that the wealthier you are, the easier it gets to get even more wealthier, and that's not because poor people have no other choice but to spend the money they earn on their necessities. And rich people invest it because they simply have too much money, but rather because rich people are less likely to default on their loans. In 2020, when the world economy went down, the government distributed stimulus bills. Finally, the Fed or the government did something to improve the lives of average people. Not the Wall Street, but gave money to ordinary people. The only problem was that's how it appeared in reality. Rich people learned the lesson from the 2008 crash: if the government directly bails you out, people will start hating you. So make it seem as if the government isn't bailing you out. When the Fed injects trillions of dollars into the economy, you know that inflation is going to fly to the roof. You don't have to be an expert to understand that home prices alone jumped by over 20%. So if you borrow $1 billion at just 1%, which is exactly what the Fed did. It loaned money to the biggest companies almost like 0%. These companies took the money and purchased assets and just waited for inflation to do its job. Think about it for the sake of example. Let's say you borrow $100,000 to buy a house at 2% mortgage rate. If home prices rise by 20% next year, you can sell that house for $120,000, pay back the $100,000 loan to the bank plus $2,000 worth of interest. And you have earned $18,000 simply by waiting for inflation to do its job. Imagine for a moment when the same thing is done with trillions of dollars, which is exactly what happened in 2020. Number 3. Banks help rich people avoid taxes. When you hear the news that Jeff Bezos has a net worth of $200 billion, or Elon Musk has a net worth of $300 billion, you have to keep in mind that they do not have $200 billion of paper money stashed in their bank accounts or backyards, but rather the amount of shares they own in their companies worth that much selling. Their stocks isn't as easy as it might seem. First of all, they have to pay a lot of taxes on that, which could be 20%. 20% out of $100 billion is $20 billion, no one wants to pay that much taxes. Secondly, an oversupply of that particular stock in the market will push the price down, so how do you spend billions of dollars while not selling your stocks? The banks have figured out a way for billionaires to do that. You can borrow money from the banks against your assets. The banks will lend you hundreds of millions of dollars, if not billions, for you to spend at a very low rate, like 1%, to buy your 100-foot yacht, a mansion, a private jet, and a few luxurious cars maybe. And you can pay them back when your company pays dividends or makes a huge profit, or when you can sell some of your shares at the right time. That's why you find billionaires like Mark Zuckerberg or Elon Musk still take mortgages for dozens of millions of dollars, even though they easily can afford those houses. Why sell your shares now when you can borrow that money at a very low rate and avoid taxes? But unfortunately, the banks aren't going to make that exception for mortal people like you and me. All billionaires have started somewhere, even those who got a small loan of $1 million from their dads. They have invested it wisely. One of the best ways to start investing is through the stock market. Now give this video a thumbs up and make sure to subscribe if you haven't done that yet. Thanks for watching, and until next time.